Hey friends, you know that Azure App Configuration externalizes your app settings so that you can manage them more easily from a central location. It's built on the simple concept of key value pairs. Azure App Configuration also includes management utilities and integration with common application frameworks. And Jimmy Campbell is here to show us how it works today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman and it's Azure Friday. I'm learning all about Azure App Configuration. Jimmy Campbell, how are you, sir?
I'm doing wonderfully. I'm happy to be here today to talk about Azure App Configuration.
Fantastic. I like doing Azure Friday because I learn about new stuff, new features in Azure that I can then apply to the apps that I've got. Because I got a bunch of app service apps out there. And maybe you have been doing it wrong all these years.
Yeah, I'm definitely excited because I think that this service will definitely be able to help developers. And from what you're talking about, it sounds like you'll be able to use this right away.
Fantastic. Yeah, right now I mostly just do things in the app settings or the configuration section of the portal. And I'm oftentimes copy-pasting, just configuration stuff, environment variables.
Right.
I've actually got one app that's in like four regions and I've got traffic manager,
right.
And it's like open up four tabs and copy paste.
Yeah, you're trying to sync things between applications. Another thing is you may even have your applications running on different platforms like AKS, and then you're running a function app. You have a whole bunch of different parts to really build your solution and you want to manage
those. Yeah, you're making me realize that I've got a virtual machine, a function, and an Azure App Service, and they all three share
exactly.
the same thing.
Exactly. If you just had one spot that you could centralize the applications with the capability to really query them at the app level and make sure they're siloed independently, and then we're a service so we can give you things like manageability, showing you the history of your configuration, things of that nature. It really helps out with these large cloud scale applications that are being developed.
Well, and the worst part is that I'm actually making it worse, as I think that we see people do in the industry, is rather than me putting it in a central location and pulling from it, I end up putting it in scripts on my local machine, and then I end up writing CLI code to push configuration out to these different diverse places.
Yeah.
And it's just gross.
Right. So there are definitely different patterns and best practices. Pulling from the application is one thing, of course, but also deploying, in your CI/CD pipelines, you can use Azure App Configuration for variables and, integrating into frameworks, platforms, CI/CD pipelines, you name the one that you use. That's our goal, to really make this available in any part of the solution that you're building.
Okay, so now I'll see the
everything is clicking now.
It's like, okay, I can figure it out, because I've got the CI/CD, I've got Azure DevOps rock solid, but I have even more stuff copy-pasted into
exactly,
there.
Exactly, right?
All right. So what do you got for me?
All right, so let's talk about creating Azure App Configuration, what the experience is like getting started, and kind of what it is. So if you want to go ahead and get started with Azure App Configuration, you can go to the Azure portal today with your subscription. We have app configuration. This is our resource. Go ahead and create one of these and you're good to go. And so ultimately I have one created already.
I have to pay for this, or is this just part of Azure?
This right now is free. You don't have to pay for this. Skewing may be a possibility right now, free to go. So just go ahead and create one and just use it.
I dig it.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay.
So I happen to already have one created. When you create Azure App Configuration, what you're essentially getting at the core level is a DNS endpoint, REST API, and this thing is what you're using to talk to create your key value settings.
Okay.
But of course, we're not making you use the REST API. We have the portal, CLI, and anything that you need to really abstract that and handle it in an easy way.
Is it a private internal API or is it a public web API?
It's a documented API, so you can look at the REST documentation.
I hit it from the outside of the world, like the internet can hit it, or is it something that I could put in a VNet and have it be private?
So right now, VNet isn't supported for the DNS, but we do see moving towards that. So, but right now, you just get your DNS and you have your authentication, of course.
Ah, there you go.
But so you do have API keys, and that's how you'd connect.
Perfect. All right.
All right. So I created a Azure App Configuration, and let's go ahead and get started looking at what exactly this looks like in the portal, what our settings look like. I'm just going to create a simple example here. Let's say I have an application, and I am showing something on a screen, and it has a color.
Okay.
So I have a color setting, and I just want to make that blue.
Right.
We do add metadata on top of this setting, content type, there's tags, but key value is the simplest thing. And so we see we created our first setting.
Okay.
You could create a bunch of these and those would be your application settings. Okay. One thing we see over here as well is label. So key value and label is something that isn't so intuitive right off the bat, but it's very important. This is a custom dimension that a developer can use to let their configuration evolve. For example, I have a key called color that I use in my application.
Right.
But maybe in North America, people like green, and in Europe, people like red. All of a sudden, I see, oh, my settings evolve across region. I'm building a global application.
Right.
So I want to use label as that dimension. Other examples may be like version of the application or SKU.
Multi-tenancy, gold, silver, platinum.
Whatever dimension,
right, whatever dimension you
want. You reference a setting by a key, but you may have a difference to change when that application is deployed.
Okay.
And that would be label.
Right. Or even A-B testing, I suppose, as well.
Exactly. And okay, let's go ahead and do an example. So what did I say? Red and North America.
Okay. North Americans get one color and everybody else gets another.
And then green and Europe.
Okay.
And so now I kind of have a dimensionalized configuration. My application only knows it's supposed to know about a color.
Right, right.
But
right.
I can see that I have this notion in North America the color is red, in Europe it's blue, and by default maybe, or in Europe it's green, and by default maybe it's blue.
Right, right. I could go and create, I've created effectively scoping, like you said, it's multi-dimensional data now, and then I could fall back and the one with no label would then be blue.
Right, right. And you would specify like what label you want to use when you're pulling your configuration, and you could say pull Europe and then pull no label to fill in the empty spots. So you can kind of have a hierarchical, you know, more
specific.
Yeah.
It's funny how something as simple as metadata can go and make something, like you said, multi-dimensional and much more flexible.
Exactly, and we let you decide what dimension you want to use to scale across your configuration.
All right, cool.
Right. Let's talk about some utilities, because at the core, we're just key values, but we add manageability on top of that. You can see in the portal right now, compare settings. I can actually compare a configuration set to another Azure app configuration. I don't have one right now, but show you comparing it across Europe and North America. I forgot how my configuration differed. Oh, I can see that. Well, the screen is a little small,
but you're killing me. I've got this one application that I've got one in Europe, I've got one in Japan, I've got one in North America.
And you can see exactly what's different between them.
I just opened up multiple tabs. It's a mess.
Well, this is going to solve that problem, I think.
Okay, cool.
That's why I'm so excited for this one. Okay. All right. So, in the course, this is all going to show you what got created, what got there might be things that exist in one and not the other. It'll show you that as well.
Okay.
And then import export.
I can put it in source control if I wanted to.
Absolutely. So import, export, you know, we're thinking right now we can do JSON file and other places to import, export to, but we'll add to that as the time goes. We want to come to where you are, make it easy, come to your platforms, your frameworks, allow you to leave, come, go with your settings. So right now I'm actually going to use this because I want to demo an ASP.NET Core app that's going to pull some settings.
Okay.
I have a JSON file sitting around right here. I'm just going to go ahead and import this JSON file in and then use it in an application. So let me import this. All right, everything looks good. We imported it. Let's go back to the Key Value Explorer, and now we'll see some, I got some settings imported. They're all starting with web demo, as we can see, which is kind of like a best practice. I mentioned how
a prefix.
We can, namespacing. I said how we could have multiple applications in our Azure app configuration.
Good point.
Now, I know if I'm running my web demo, I just take the keys that start with web demo.
Yep.
That's what my app, my application doesn't care about anything else.
And if you were doing something that with, again, with multi-tenancy, that could be a part of that, that dimension as well.
Right, but for the application, it's always querying the using the setting by the same name, so you wouldn't want the namespacing to be anything that changes.
Oh, interesting. Okay,
so think about it. When you use it in code, it's always supposed to stay the same.
Right.
The label could be for things that evolve.
Ah, okay, good.
Right, right.
Okay, cool.
Okay, so I have these settings here. And now let's go into the ASP.NET Core code. I can show you, we ship a NuGet package called Microsoft Extensions Configuration.Azure App Configuration.
Nice.
And this is going to plug into the .NET Core configuration, kind of like you would expect it with other configuration
providers. Yeah, it looks very natural. I see there on line 26, you go and just add it because it's an extension method. And then once you drop in the location, that DNS that you mentioned before, that azconfig.io.
Right. So you can connect with a connection string.
Right.
That is one supported method. Of course, you get your connection string from the portal. Actually, one of the beautiful things I get to do here is use manage identity for Azure services. So all I have to do is pass the identifier, you know, the DNS name for my Azure app configuration, and I'm just going to connect. I don't have to worry about connection strings.
Interesting. So because it knows the managed identity of that running in Azure and ASP.NET, it's got this nice extension, that we haven't even seen a connection string. You haven't copy-pasted anything?
I'm not using a connection string. My Azure App Configuration gave permission for my app service to read key values. I don't have to worry about connection
strings. That's pretty cool, because you're actually bootstrapping configuration without using configuration. Like, there's no config strings.
Isn't it beautiful?
That's pretty hot.
Okay.
I dig it.
This is the namespacing I talked about before. I'm using a key filter of web demo, and I'm watching and reloading all of my configuration based on a certain key. This
that
is to help prevent splicing. Right. I don't want to change some settings, and then I want to change one key and then have all the things shifted. So.
And .NET people are used to changing configuration and then reloading the entire application. But in a world of five nines, we can't be doing that. We can't be restarting every time we change a web
Absolutely. Config. Absolutely. You can't afford to do that. I mean, unless your orchestrator is really involved in that somehow.
No,
but
this is much nicer. So you're going and polling that at a user configurable poll interval.
Right.
And then bringing that in.
What we're doing is we're going to bind that to a data model for the purpose of this demo. So we're binding it to a simple data model. We're ultimately bringing that data model to our Razor page. And then we're just going to show some key values on the page, or show some settings of that model on the page. So I can show that we're getting the settings, and then we're going to see the settings change on the fly. Just kind of.
And in this case here, you're actually dynamically generating CSS, which is very nice. It's inline style.
So yes, Razor pages love it.
Yeah, it's very cool.
All right, so let me go ahead. We have the settings here, and I have this application, which now is going to be loading those settings when I reload it. So you can see I do have here data from Azure App Configuration.
Okay.
I didn't have that setting before, but now that I loaded it and reload the page, now it's displaying.
Okay.
But let's say we are watching these settings. Let's just go ahead and change it, because the orange,
Not
really working for me either. So we can go ahead and change the background color here. It's just one of the things I happen to have configurable. And maybe I like green a little better today. Okay. And then the font size was a little small. So let's change that one to just maybe 55. It's a little bigger than 30.
All right.
And this message should be a little bit more personal, because we're feeling happy today on Friday.
Okay.
So howdy. From Azure Fridays, smiley.
Excellent.
All right. Now, actually, if I was to change this now, nothing's going to happen because the sentinel didn't change. You know, we wanted to prevent the splicing.
Right.
So let me go ahead and change that. Doesn't matter what it changes to. It's just looking for a change.
Okay. So it's pivoted on the sentinel. Because actually, one of the things that I expected to happen, and I was wrong, was that I thought it was updating in on a timer, and we'd see, depending on when you hit refresh, some of them change and not others change.
Right, and that's the splicing we want to prevent, right? So this is kind of why you can do that if you want.
Yeah, but you don't want it in a weird state
where
some things that are dependent.
You can call watch and not watch and reload all. It will give you that behavior if that's what you wish, but ultimately, we don't want to cause splicing in your application.
That is very thoughtful.
So now, howdy from Azure Fridays. Oh, looks like I made the font a little too big.
That's all right. Easily fixed in configuration.
We can fix that right away.
So
that's Azure App Configuration, helping solve the manageability, the availability, and of that developers are facing today when they're managing their applications across all these different microservices, platforms. You have your CI/CD.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that.
So people can go and email you and the team at azureappconfig@microsoft.com. They can go check it out in the documentation. It's all live right now.
Yes, it is.
We saw some really, really nice integration with ASP.NET Core, but of course it's non-denominational.
Right, right.
Works with any language that can talk REST, which is all of them.
And we're constantly looking where the developers are, and we're coming. So we have right now, of course, we have ASP.NET Core, NetFX, Java Spring Cloud, to name a few. So there's that, and also integration with platforms. So we see right now we're utilizing managed identity for Azure services, and we see we're using app services, function apps, config maps, and AKS. We see where we can come and make ourselves easy for you to access.
Fantastic. So. All right. Well, I'm learning all about Azure App Configuration. I'm going to go back and change all my apps and make them better now today on Azure Friday.